We are going to start the lecture continuation of the muscle tone. We have already seen the basic receptor for the muscle tone. That is, in the last lecture, we have studied about the introduction, what is muscle tone, what is the receptor for the muscle tone. The receptor for the muscle tone is the muscle spindle. We have seen about the structure, innervation, and function. Today, we will see how the tone is developed and what are the various significance of the it. Now, we all know that muscle tone, it is defined as the partial contraction, even at the rest, is called as the muscle tone. And basically, it is determined by the stretch reflex, depends upon the stretch reflex and the receptor or the muscle spindle. And the receptor for it is the muscle spindle. Now, in the muscle spindle, we have seen that there are two types of fiber, that is the extrafusal fiber and the intrafusal fiber. So, these muscle spindles, they are located at the tendon attaching to the skeleton. So, these muscle spindles, they are made up of two types of fibers, like extrafusal and the intrafusal fibers. They are encapsulated. And the intrafusal fibers are again in turn made up of two types of fibers, that is the nuclear back fibers and the nuclear chain fibers. In nuclear back fibers, the nucleus are getting collected in the center, and the nuclear chain fibers, the nucleus are arranged in the chain like manner. We have also seen the innervation of it. The innervation is mainly by the primary afferent, which forms the annulospinal ring, which surrounds mainly the nuclear bag and the nuclear chain fibers. These are group 1A type of fibers, whereas the group 2 type of fibers, they are mainly forming the flower spray ending and they mainly innervate the nuclear chain type of fibers. These are the sensory inputs, that is the sensory afferents, which are carrying the information to the spinal cord. Whereas the efferent fibers, they are mainly from the beta fibers and the gamma efferent fibers. These gamma efferent fibers are again gamma 1 and gamma 2, which determine the static as well as the dynamic type of response. We know what is dynamic response and what is the static response. This basically, the muscle tone, it is being governed by the stretch reflex. And the stretch reflex, it is the monosynaptic reflex, which carries the information through the sensory organ. Here, in this case, the sensory organ is the proprioceptor, that is in the form of muscle spindle. So it carries the sensory information, goes to the spinal cord, and from spinal cord it will innervate the fibers and it will form a synaptic connection with the center, and through this the motor neurons will be carried from the alpha motor neuron to the extrafusal fibers as well as in the form of dynamic and the static efferent fibers. Now, this dynamic stretch reflex is mainly when there is a sudden change in the length. So when a stimulus, there is a change in the length, that time it gives the response. The firing will be more, and this efferent fibers are mainly the gamma 2 type of fibers, which are mainly coming from the nuclear back fiber. Whereas the static fibers, they are continuous firing. Means as long as the stretch is applied or as long as the muscle is stretching, they will give the information. So, this is about the overview. We have seen, now we are going to see about the control or the maintenance of the stretch reflex or the muscle tone. So, this maintenance of the muscle tone is done by the two fundamental mechanisms, like the spinal mechanism by means of the stretch reflex and the supraspinal mechanism. Now, the supraspinal mechanism, it is mainly done by the control by the higher center and the other center. These higher centers, these are located in the cerebral cortex via descending tract. Now, these descending motor fibers, they are from either the descending tracts are pyramidal tract and the extrapyramidal tract. So, both these tracts will terminate on the anterior horn cells. And on the anterior horn cells, they are mainly influence causing on the alpha motor neuron. So, anterior horn cell has got both alpha motor neuron and the gamma motor neuron. So, they will influence this alpha or gamma motor activity and thus further modify the tone of the muscle. About 30% of the anterior horn cells belongs to alpha motor neurons, whereas the remaining 70% belongs to 30% belongs to gamma motor neuron, and 70% will be belonging to the alpha motor neuron. Then it also distracts platelets. Other muscle cells also modified by the subcortical gray matters, that is mainly the basal ganglia. We have seen the basal ganglia in detail, and we know that basal ganglia has got an inhibitory influence on the gamma efferent fibers. So normally the basal ganglia will cause inhibition of the gamma motor. Vestibular apparatus has got the vestibular nucleus, and the vestibular nucleus has got influence on the alpha motor neuron. They mainly modify the firing of the alpha motor neuron. Similarly, the final, that is supraspinal mechanism of the control, is called cerebellum. Cerebellum is also having both alpha motor gamma cerebral cortex. Now, all this will help in supraspinal control of the stretch reflex, and in turn it will modify the muscle tone. Please mute the songs. The higher area of control, this higher area of the control, it is mainly from the facilitatory and the inhibitory reticular formation. Now, this facilitatory reticular formation is the area located in the brainstem, and it has got increases the gamma motor neuron discharge. And whenever there is an increase in the gamma motor neuron discharge, it will cause the muscle tone, is because of the asynchronous discharge from the gamma efferent fiber. So that will create a more tone. Then second is the vestibular nucleus. This vestibular nucleus acts directly on the alpha motor neuron. Then inhibitory reticular formation, this is also located in the reticular formation, but in the reticular formation there are two areas, that is the facilitatory area and the inhibitory area. So this inhibitory area will cause inhibition of the gamma motor neuron discharge, whereas the facilitatory area will cause increase in the gamma efferent firing. Then as I said, cerebral cortex and the cerebellum, this reflexly inhibit by stimulating the inhibitory reticular formation. Then inhibitory area in the brain by basal ganglia, it acts by inhibiting the reticular formation, and in turn it inhibits the motor cortex. So it has got a negative influence on the gamma motor firing. The mechanism by which alpha gamma co-activation takes place. Now, alpha motor neuron constitute the final pathway of the motor output signals from the CNS. If you remember the reflexes, there is one common pathway. What means is one of the property of the reflexes. So in this, final output is always by the alpha motor neuron. So the alpha motor neuron mainly innervate the extrafusal fibers, whereas the gamma motor neuron innervate the intrafusal fibers. So whenever there is an alpha motor neuron, that is, they are responsible for generation of force. So the extrafusal fibers mainly generate the force, that is force with which the contraction is taking place. Now this gamma motor neuron innervates the intrafusal fibers. These intrafusal fibers are located deep inside the muscle belly, and they are sensitive. They modulate the sensitivity of the muscle spindle, and they will help in regulating the length and the tone of the muscle. So we have seen in the stretch reflex, that is the length servo mechanism and the force servo mechanism, that is the tone servo mechanism. Now this descending pathway that stimulate the gamma motor neuron will also stimulate the alpha motor neuron. So therefore, whenever there is a gamma efferent fiber discharge increases, this will cause discharge of the alpha motor neuron, and this linkage, that is both alpha as well as the gamma together, it is called as alpha gamma coactivation. So these are the descending pathways coming in the form of pyramidal tract and the extra pyramidal tract. Both these will form a termination on the alpha motor neuron that is present in the anterior horn cells. Now in the anterior horn cell, there is the gamma motor neuron and the alpha motor neuron. Now it will innervate both alpha and the gamma. Alpha is causing the contraction of the extrafusal fibers, and the gamma is causing the contraction of the intrafusal fibers. And This together will help in developing the tone in the muscle. So this is called as alpha gamma co-activation. Now how does it control the muscle tone? Now from the cerebral cortex, cerebellum, basal ganglia and reticular nucleus, all this will causes the positive effect. That is, it causes facilitatory area in the reticular formation, that is bulbo reticular area and the facilitatory area of the pons. So because of this, there will be a positive influence on the gamma motor neuron discharge on the spinal cord. At the same time, the cerebral cortex, cerebellum also stimulate the bulbo reticular inhibitory area, which is present in the medulla. So this will cause inhibition of the gamma motor neuron firing on the spinal cord. So the final output is the balance of this gamma motor neuron discharge in the spinal cord. So this gamma is being stimulating the mainly innervate the intrafusal fibers. So the intrafusal fibers, whenever there is a increasing the gamma motor neuron discharge, it will cause stretching of the muscle spindle. And when the stretching of the muscle spindle take place, it causes, that is, the capsule will be getting stretched, and this will give the sensory input to the alpha activation of the alpha motor neuron. And this alpha motor neuron in turn is stimulating the extrafusal fibers. So there occurs partial contraction of the muscle. And this is why the muscle in the resting condition are in the state of partial contraction. Then inhibition of the stretch reflex. Now this inhibition of the stretch reflex, it is taking place by two mechanisms. That is, the first mechanism by the reciprocal inhibition. What is this reciprocal inhibition? When an agonist muscle is contracting in order to cause the desired motion, it usually forces the antagonist muscle to relax. And this phenomena is called as reciprocal inhibition, because of antagonist muscles are being inhibited from contraction. So it means that when the muscle is contracted, significance of this reciprocal inhibition is it ensures the movement of inverse stretch reflex. Relaxation is in response to the strong stretch or autogenic inhibitions, and the receptor for this is mainly the Golgi tendon organ. So its significance is mainly it is a protective and prevent the muscle from getting tearing, and it also helps in regulating the tension during the normal muscle activity. Then role of muscle tone. How does the regulation of muscle tone is being taking place? So we have seen that the muscles are in the state of partial contraction, and this state of partial contraction is mainly helpful for maintenance of posture. So this partial state of contraction is because of low frequency and asynchronous discharge of the gamma motor neuron, and this is helping in resisting to the lengthening if achieved. So how does this development of muscle tone take place? When there is a stretching, the sensory fibers from A1A type of fibers will carry the information and will form a synaptic connection in the spinal cord. So these impulses from the gamma motor neuron will be causing activation of the intrafusal fibers and generation of impulse. Now when this in activation is taking place and the impulses being generated in the intrafusal fibers, these impulses will be transmitted to the spinal cord via the afferent fiber. These afferent fibers are in the form of 1A, that is primary annular spiral ring, or the flower spray entry. This both will carry the information to the spinal cord, and this will cause stimulation of alpha motor neuron. When this alpha motor neuron gets stimulated, its transmission of impulse via the efferent fibers will be taking place, and the alpha motor neuron will help in stimulation of the extrafusal fibers. And when the extrafusal fibers get contracted, a muscle will be in a state of partial contraction, leading to development of muscle tone. Now, alteration in the tone. Whenever there is a decrease in the tone, it is called as hypotonia. Now, the decreased tone, hypotonia, it is seen mainly whenever there is a destruction of the locus reflex arc in the pathway. If it is destructed, there will be leading to hypotonia. And this local destruction is seen whenever there is a destruction of efferent motor neuron to the muscles by injury or poliomyelitis, there will be hypotonia. Or destruction of dorsal column or the sensory tract, as it is seen in the syphilis, it will lead to the hypotonia. Then other causes of hypotonia are stimulation of inhibitory areas of the higher centers, like inhibitory area in the reticular formation. Then inhibition or destruction of the facilitatory area in the brainstem, like facilitatory area or verboreticular area of the pons. This is a facilitatory area. If it gets destructed, it will cause, that is, hypotonia during sleep, and certain drugs, like drugs that will be given which will cause the hypotonia, or maybe the barbiturate, tranquilizers in high doses will cause hypotonia. Similarly, if there is a destruction of the cerebellum, it will cause inhibition of the alpha, and therefore there will be hypotonia. Then increase in the tone is called as hypertonia. There are two types of hypertonia, that is spasticity. In spasticity, hypertonia is seen only in one group of muscles, and it is mainly cause of, that is, whenever there is a lesion in the internal capsule or pyramidal tract lesion, there occurs spasticity, and these lesions are mainly of the upper motor neuron type of lesion. Then rigidity, it is hypertonia in both extensor as well as the flexor muscles, and the rigidity is mainly seen whenever there is a lesion of the basal ganglia. So we know that there occurs either the convent rigidity or the lead pipe type of rigidity. It is mainly because of increase in the tone in the muscle, and because of increased tone, more gamma efferent fibers will be discharging, and that will be All Munabai MBBS, please shut down your mobiles. The names are coming, who is talking or who are Munabais. So their names are coming and displaying on the site. So Munabai has left now. Harsha Kabre or Kabra. So please. Don't do, the names are been displaying and I'm noting down the names. So whenever we will be having a live class, that time I will talk to you. So this is an animation, how does it activate? So the innervation of the skeletal muscle, the arm is given a command to do a particular position. So in this, the muscle So the weight is applied onto the arm. When the weight is applied, this weight will push down the arm, which causes the stretching of the muscle. Now, whenever the muscle will be stretched, the muscle spindle will get stimulated. There will be afferent fiber, that is the sensory neurons, will be getting stimulated, and this will carry the information by the sensory neurons. So the stretch will be detected by the sensory neuron in the arm and is transferred to the interneuron in the spinal cord. So the 1A fiber or the primary anterospinal ring fibers will be, these are the sensory fibers of 1A type. So they will carry the information to the interneurons present in the spinal cord. And from there, the impulse will be transmitted through the alpha motor neuron to the extrafusal fibers. So the command will be contract the muscle is sent to the alpha motor neuron. The clinical application of the stretch reflex, this is mainly used, it is the purpose to determine how much background excitation is required to develop a tone, and the brain is sending these signals to the spinal cord. And this reflex is elicited as follows, like we have demonstrated on the clinical examination, like knee jerk and the bicep jerk, tricep jerk, all these jerk are the examples of the stretch reflex. So clinically, a method is used to determine the sensitivity of the stretch is to initiate the muscle jerk. Now the knee jerk can be elicited by striking on the patellar tendon with the help of hammer. So this instantly causes the stretching in the quadriceps muscles.
Lockdown mein is man ki baat nahi sun
rahe. Stretch reflex.
Ki baat ke liye.
So this that causes the lower leg to get jerk forward, and there is a diagram. So when we give a tap on the patellar tendon, the reflex C, the quadriceps muscles, its reflex is to extend the knee. So the jerky movement will be seen and the knee will be extended in a forward direction. So this response can be noted down by the instrument, that is myogram, which will help in recording the gastrocnemius, that is the knee jerk recording. So you can see this, how it will be recorded. Now the clonus, the muscle jerk, used by the neurologist to assess the degree of facilitation of the spinal cord center. So either the reflex will be exaggerated or the reflex will be decreased in the response. So whenever there is a exaggerated reflexes, it indicates that the large number of facilitatory impulses are being transmitted from the upper regions to the central nervous system into the cord, and secondly the region in the motor area of the cerebral.
मेरे प्यारे देशवासियों, नमस्कार। आप सब लॉकडाउन में इस मन की बात को सुन रहे हैं।
It is a facilitatory impulse will be depressed, and the significance of this is this reflex are used most frequently in determining the presence or absence of the muscle spasticity caused by lesions in the motor areas of the brain or the diseases that excite the bulbo-reticular facilitatory areas of the brain stem. So this is bulbo-reticular area is a facilitatory area in the reticular formation. So whenever this is excited, this will be, the reflex will be extended. Clinical significance, that is clonus is oscillation of muscle jerk. So there is an increase in the activity, just a minor stimulus given to the plantar because the clonus can be elicited. So increased reflex activity is characterized by repeated muscular contraction produced by the stretch. It occurs only when the stretch reflex is slightly sensitized by the facilitatory impulses from the brain. Commonly seen in the decerebrate animals in which the stretch reflex is highly facilitated and the clonus